So today let's take a look at my DIY thermometer and how did I build it. And this time I'm showing the final state at the beginning of the video and then I will show the process of building it and optimizing it. I've actually made two versions. One is a bit simpler, it's meant to run on a power supply and it has two buttons, one to record the maximum temperature, one to record the minimum one, and pressing both will reset the maximum and minimum memory. And the second version, which is this one, is optimized for battery operation. It runs on 3 AA's, nickel metal hydride or alkaline. It again has two buttons, but one is to record the maximum and minimum memory. When you press it, it alternately shows the minimum and maximum. And after a couple seconds, it goes back to the current temperature. And the second button is to set the brightness of the display to minimize the consumption. This is optimized for battery operation. And a long press can turn it off. And then this one actually turns it back on. So that's the second version, a bit improved, and the current consumption of it is minimized. And both versions are on my website, and the links will be in the description, including both schematics and both versions of the program for the microcontroller. And yes, this is the temperature here. It's quite hot, it's summer, and I need a fire extinguisher. And now let's see how I test it in a breadboard and then build it. And of course testing it in a breadboard using my DIY bench power supply. And it draws just a bit over 4 milliamps. That's quite a low current. At 3.6 volts about. And the display doesn't even look dim. It's a nice mostly sunny day. I chose the brightest display that I have in my display hoarding box. And the microcontroller with no display draws just 0.23 milliamps. And the display resistors are now 270 ohms. It's weird that when I set the brownout detector to 2.7 volts and set the voltage to about 2.6, it now shuts down because of undervoltage and now it draws 1.7 milliamps. And now setting it just above the threshold, it starts up and draws 0.7 milliamps. And now the display is already dimly on and it's weird because when it's in the undervoltage shutdown, it actually draws more current. I removed the display and this is the consumption of the microcontroller itself and this is about 2.8 volts and now 2.6 volts. When it shuts down because of a low voltage, it draws almost 10 times as much. This could cause a deep discharge of your battery. With the brownout detector deactivated, the current consumption of the microcontroller stays low even under 2.7 volts. And at 2.5 volts, the display draws virtually no current. It's a pure green display, not the yellowish green one. This one has a higher voltage drop. And now it draws 0.24 milliamps. Now majority of it is the microcontroller. To protect your batteries against a deep discharge, it's probably better to have the brownout detector not activated. Replacing the 270 ohm resistor for the number 6 using an 820 ohm resistor, about 3 times the resistance, and the number 6 still looks quite visible, and I don't even see much difference in the brightness at 1/3 of the current. Of course now it's showing the maximum possible reading because I disconnected the voltage reference. Now it's all 820 ohm resistors and it's nicely readable under a window on a sunny day. Nice. This is running at 3.3 volts and it draws just 1.35 milliamps from the battery, or power supply now actually. But it could run on the battery for probably several weeks. These are super high efficiency displays. Of course you could run an LCD thermometer on a battery for several years continuously, but an LED display running continuously on a battery for several weeks is amazing. And of course I'm replacing the TL431 voltage reference with something that draws just about 1 microamp, because otherwise the TL431 voltage reference would be about half of the total consumption. This is the current at 3.6 volts and 4.2 volts. So that's ATmega 8A, and this basically has two buttons. One shows the maximum recorded temperature, one shows the minimum recorded temperature, and pressing both resets the minimum and maximum memory. So that's the final state of the version with ATmega 8A. The schematic and program will be on my website, the link will be in the description. Now I want to also make a version with ATmega 88PA. The newer version, which is pin compatible but not a direct replacement, it needs a bit different program. So let's make a program for 88PA and let's see if it has a lower power consumption. So that's the chips. Let's leave the program of this one where it is, and now let's make a program for this one, which needs a slight modification, and then let's also maybe add a brightness control for the display and maybe a standby function so it doesn't have to have a switch in series with the battery. Now the program is converted for the newer chip, 88PA, and it draws 0.2 milliamps. I was actually expecting a bigger improvement, a bit higher current consumption reduction in comparison to 8A. The consumption went from about 0.23 to about 0.19, and this is again without the display and voltage reference, but with the temperature sensor, and disconnecting the temperature sensor doesn't seem to make any difference. Now a very short shutter, and you can actually see the multiplex. With a longer shutter, this effect disappears. And 80Mega88PA, just below the brownout detector threshold, 2.7 volts, draws almost half a milliamp. Much better than 80Mega8A, but the entry voltage condition still more than doubles the current draw. Now with the new program, when I switch it off using the button to power down the deepest sleep mode, it draws 17 microamps with the 2.7 volt brownout detector activated. Quite low current, but with the brownout detector disabled, it's like 0.1 microamp. With the voltage reference and the temperature sensor disconnected, reconnecting the temperature sensor and it draws about 5 or 6 microamps. A TL431 voltage reference requires about 1 milliamp at least to guarantee it's working well, so let's give it a different voltage reference or maybe a tiny voltage regulator actually. This one for its own operation draws about 1.2 microamps, and the minimum dropout of this one is just a couple millivolts at low current, and the reference is 2.5 volts, so the entire thermometer could run down to just a little over 2.5 volts. But at this voltage, the pure green display passes virtually no current. And the temperature sensor runs down to 2.3 volts and the chip down to 1.8 volts. The older one down to 2.7 volts. Maybe with a lower voltage reference it could run on two alkaline AAs, but then you have to use a red display with a lower voltage drop, which is probably going to be less efficient, so it's not worth it. I think three alkaline or nickel metal hydride or nickel cadmium cells are the right amount. Or of course a lithium ion battery. And of course the current consumption of this voltage regulator will depend mostly on the resistive divider with the adjustment potentiometer in it. You could of course use a voltage reference which supplies straight the right voltage for the analog to digital converter, but then you have no option to calibrate it. So I'm using a voltage reference with the nearest voltage higher than this. And of course the external voltage reference pin of the microcontroller requires some capacitor in parallel, especially if the reference is high impedance. Every time the analog to digital converter takes a sample, it pulls the voltage on the reference pin couple tens of millivolts down, and then the parallel capacitor recharges. And two succeeding channels of the multiplex of the display and the pulse width modulation of the brightness. The multiplex is about 100 Hz and the highest brightness is 10% duty cycle, and every time you reduce the brightness it halves. Now it's about 5, 2.5 and so on. Now instead of powering the voltage reference and the temperature sensor straight from the battery, they are powered from two outputs of the microcontroller, and these are only high when it's active and they are low when it's off in power down. This is of course to make the entire device draw virtually zero current when it's off. I've used 2.5 volt voltage reference because I had it, but maybe it would be more convenient to use a 2.1 volt voltage reference. Because it's much closer to 2.048 volts, the resistive divider would have much lower impedance at the output without having to pass more current. And of course the potentiometer is a multiplier calibration, it's just a single point calibration. Of course it would be also possible to give it some sort of linear shift calibration, some sort of offset. It would be possible to do it by software, and of course it would be also possible to make it measure its battery voltage. But at this point, I already have a feeling I'm horribly over-engineering it. So let's leave it there. I don't have to give it a Bluetooth, a Wi-Fi, a camera with a face recognition and so on. It's just a bloody thermometer. According to my previous experiences with these sensors, they are pre-calibrated from a manufacturer quite well. The error is just a small fraction of a degree Celsius. At 0 degree, they were just 0.1 Celsius off at most. And using a potentiometer to simulate the output of the sensor, now it goes up. The zero is suppressed to save the battery. And over 100. And up to this reading, where it stops. I cut the prototyping board to fit into the box, trying to visualize how the display and microcontroller is going to go in, and marking it on the board. And then I just cut the stripes in three lines, under the displays, under the microcontroller, and between the displays and the microcontroller. And then just wire it together and that's it. Some more markings on the board. The board is cut. Putting some jumpers on the board. Now some socket. Soldering it. Of course a bucket of rosin has to be used for it. And a lot of solder, the more the better. Now the display is wired to the microcontroller and it has the resistors. And now it has the voltage reference on the back. Who can find it? Spoiler alert, it's here. And on the other side of the board, here is the potentiometer, its resistors, some capacitors, the resistor powering the reference, and that's it. Not sure if this is the best choice of buttons and the mounting technique. What the hell is this in the battery holder? The rivet is loose in it, inside of the spring. Chinese quality. You always have to have more pieces to choose from. What about putting magnets under the battery holder so I can stick it to the machine? I'm measuring the temperature of. Wiring it all together. Now it's very close to finished. Just connect the probe to it and that's it. Of course, without it, it shows random numbers. Let's put one of these temperature sensors on a cable. Let's use glue and heat shrinks to make a waterproof probe. Let's connect the cable to it like this. This is always a bit tricky. You have to prepare the heat shrinks on the wires. After soldering it, put the heat shrinks over it and shrink it. And some larger heat shrink over the outside and seal it using a glue. Maybe one more. But of course, if you really want it waterproof, you have to put one layer over the outside of the sensor. Of course, this slows down the thermal transfer, but it really makes it waterproof, and I did it to one of the probes about 10 years ago. The probe is sitting on the roof, and it still works after 10 years. In the rain, snow, sun, all the elements. I put it slightly over and pour glue into here. And also here. Before it solidifies, I heat shrink it. I put the cable into the box and soldered it to the board. Now screw the board in. And that's it. And that's actually the temperature here. It seems to work. The brightness setting. And the maximum and minimum memory. Minimum, maximum and resetting the memory. And turning it off. And that's the reference voltage. And looking at the probe made 10 years ago and the rubber cable, the rubber insulation of it seems to be a bit deteriorated. From the sun probably, but the heat shrink not so much. Nice. Definitely not bad for 10 years under the elements on the roof. The sun, snow, rain, and so on. And of course, here's the schematic of the new version. And of course, the printer cut it a little bit, but anyway. Here's the battery, the parallel capacitor. Here's the voltage reference and the sensor. They're not powered straight from the battery. They're powered from the pin of the microcontroller, so they can be shut down. The input and output of the voltage reference have decoupling capacitors, one micro multi-layer ceramic capacitors. I tested it actually works without them, but I put them there because the datasheet says they should be there. Here's the voltage divider going from 2.5 volts to 2.048 with the adjustment potentiometer. Here's the temperature sensor. This one probably doesn't need a capacitor at the output, but this is more against the interference because it's on a several meter cable. And here's the capacitor in parallel to the voltage reference input of the microcontroller. And this has to be at least 100 nano, but according to my tests, it's more accurate with 1 micro. With no capacitor here, it doesn't work. And of course, it could be even higher, but then it takes a bit too long before it charges from the divider. And the voltage reference and the temperature sensor have this series resistor, and this has several functions. It's an interference filter filtering out the digital noise from the microcontroller. It also limits the inrush when this capacitor charges when this pin goes high, but it also limits the current if the reference or the sensor goes short circuit. And of course, you can also damage the temperature sensor or its cable. You could cut it or crush it or melt it and cause a short circuit in the cable, so it's better to have a current limiting resistor. And this can be anything from a couple hundred ohms to about 1 kilo ohm. I put about 680 ohms in it because I just grabbed it randomly. But the values of these resistors in the divider are critical. Here are the buttons and some decoupling capacitors on the pins of the microcontroller. I put two on it because it has two pairs of supply voltage pins. And the resistors in series with the display anodes and the display. And I added a fuse in series with the battery out of paranoia. And I think there is also a PV and V version of this microcontroller. It should work with them as well. The program should be compatible with all versions of ATmega88, but of course not 8. And the current consumption at maximum brightness is about 4.6 milliamps. This would be about 2 or 3 weeks on 2000 mAh batteries, typical capacity for AA's. Second level, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. This would be about 7 months. So that's it, and please consider supporting my channel on Patreon or using the thanks function. This really helps me a lot. And big thanks to all of you who already support me. And using it to monitor the temperature in a freezer, and this is the minimum and the maximum.